What are locators? I'm going to give you some introduction to locators, guys. What exactly are locators? Do anyone know what are locators? Can anyone? Okay, someone is pinging on chat. Yes, something used to find an item on web page. Okay, that's fine. Something. So Chris has pinged me on chat saying that something used to find an item on a web page. Something used to find an item on a web page. This is correct. This is correct, guys. So let me explain in detail. Anyhow, yeah, find an element on the screen means web page itself. Yes, correct. Okay, finding an element on screen, that is UI object. Yes, that is also correct. Fine. Here, if I go to any website page like this, there are lot of UI elements you can see on this page. There are a lot of UI elements, guys. There is a kind of button kind of thing is there here. Menu options are there. Text box fields are there. Okay. And this kind of drop list is there. Some options are there. This kind of images are being displayed. Okay, so there are different products and their options like add to cart, add to wish list, compare this product. Lot of UI elements are being displayed on this page, including this logo text. Many things, okay, many things, hyperlinks, images, text box fields, buttons, like that. Many things are displayed on this web page, right? Many things are displayed on this web page. So all these elements are nothing but the UI elements. UI objects are elements, you can say. Okay, UI elements, simply UI elements you can call. There are different type of UI elements. So in order to understand these locators, you need to understand what exactly these UI elements are first. Okay, so let me take another website here. That is omaya.blogspot.com. It is a example website where you can see a lot of UI elements created on this web page. As you can see, some images there. Okay, this is an image. And here you can see multi-selection box where you can select multiple options. Then you have a drop-down field where you can select only one option at a time, either this option or this option, like that. This is a drop-down field. Okay, this is like multi-selection where you can select more than one option, but here in the drop down you can only select one option at a time. And this is some sample text. Okay, I mean text, casual text. And this is a hyperlink. If you click on this, it will take you to a particular page. And this is a button. You can see some button here, right? A lot of people know what exactly the UI elements are, right? Already you know what are UI elements. So I'm just taking you in a different way. This is a button. I'm just giving you the different names for different UI elements. This is a button, and this is also a button, but is in disabled state. Whereas you can click on this button, you cannot click on this. Okay, it's a disabled button. So this is a disabled text box. You cannot type anything into this. Okay, so it's a text box field, but you cannot type anything. Now, any other examples here? Let me see. This is a text area field, guys, not a text box field. This is a text box field. In text box field, you can type only in a single line, right? Only single line is possible. But in text area field, you can type in multiple lines like this. This is a text area field. And we have a table. This is a table, guys, with rows and columns. Column headings, and these are the records. Record 1, record 2, record 3, record 4, data records. In the table, under the table heading, this is the table heading. Under that we have the table data records. Overall, this is a table. Now These are text box fields, and this particular text box fields have some labels like username. Label is there for this first text box field in this HTML form, and for the second text box field there is a password label. Okay, these are called as labels. And anyhow, this is a login button. That's fine. These are frames, iframes. I will be explaining more about iframes in the upcoming videos. Okay, there are two iframes embedded inside the master page. In this omaya.blogspot.com, we have this embedded iframes. Now, any other things left? Let me see. Image is already covered. Yeah, radio options. Okay, what's the use of the radio options? Okay, radio button or radio options. Yeah, so here either you can only select one of them at a time, right? You cannot select both. Can you select both here? Both male and female can be selected here? No, only one is possible. When you select male, female will be not selected, unselected. When you select female, male will not be selected. Only one option at a time can be selected in this radio buttons or radio options. Now, next thing, this is an alert, guys. Okay, when I click on this button, I'm getting an alert on the screen saying hello with a button called as okay. This is an alert. Now, these are checkbox options. I'm explaining different UI elements, possible UI elements. Okay, so it's good to know what are the different type of UI elements. So I will not be able to cover all the possible UI elements, but I'm just trying to cover the high level, at a high level, what exactly the UI elements are. So here, orange checkbox field is there and blue checkbox field is there. What is the difference between the radio buttons and checkbox options? Can anyone? What is the difference between the radio buttons versus checkbox fields or options? Checkbox options, let's say. So anyone?
Do the checkbox options allow you to do multiple?
Okay. Yes, correct. That's correct. So checkbox options, at a time you can opt multiple options. You see, at the same time I said I opted for orange, and at same time I opted for blue. But in case of radio buttons or radio options, you can only select one option at a time. Opt one option at a time. Here, multiple options can be opted at a same time. You can even unselect all the options. But here you cannot unselect. Only at least one option should be in selected mode. Okay, so you cannot unselect this option. But in case of radio, in case of checkbox option, you can unselect both the options. Okay, none of the options are selected here. But here at least one option should be opted. And here at a time, multiple options can be opted in case of checkbox options. So that's the difference. Now, read-only text box field means you cannot type anything into this. I am trying to type something into this, but I am not able to because this is a read-only one. So whatever the text that is displayed in this particular text box field, that will be displayed and we'll not be able to edit it. Next, we have a prompt. Click on the get prompt button so that you will get this kind of prompt where it will ask you to enter something. Okay, in the alert there was nothing, no interaction was there, right? It was directly in the earlier case when I explained about alert. Here, alert will display you some text with some button, that's it. Okay, you cannot interact with the some dialogue that is coming there. But in case of prompt, it's asking me my name. I can enter my name like this, okay, Arun Moturi, and say okay. This is possible in case of prompt. Some kind of interaction is there when compared to alert. Then the next type of similar kind of alert and prompt is confirmation dialogue. Okay, so this is a confirmation dialogue, guys. Generally we keep on getting this kind of confirmation dialogues while using the applications where you can either select okay or cancel. I can either cancel or say okay. Okay, like you have to give your confirmation whether you are okay, yes or no, some kind of things. Okay, yes means okay, no means cancel, something like this. Now here there is some button, but is in hidden state, guys. It's not even in disabled state. Here If I see, if I take you to some buttons, this particular button is in enabled state. Where is that button? We have to see some, yeah, this button, button 2 is in enabled state. You can click on this. And here you can see some button, but you cannot perform any operations because this is a disabled button. Okay. And coming to the other one here, hidden button is there. That means there is a button here, but you are not able to see on the web page. So three types of buttons, right? Visible buttons, visible and enabled, visible and not enabled, and not visible at all. Then these are the hyperlinks. Okay, kind of listed hyperlinks. Now any other things we have, that's fine guys, this is all good. Okay, now we understood what exactly are the UI elements. So UI elements are something, so something like we can see on the UI elements will be available on the web pages, and few examples for them are, what are the examples guys? Out of all the things I just now walked through, can you give me some examples at a high level for UI elements?
Enable.
What is that?
Enable. Enable.
Okay. Button is something. I didn't get what you are saying. You can ping me. Yeah, that is a button. Overall, it is a button. Okay, at a high level, it is a button. Yes, hyperlink. Hyperlink is also a UI element. Any other UI elements? Yeah, checkbox options, drop downs, and so on. Okay, that's fine. This is fine. This is good. Okay, so these are all nothing but the UI elements, including the images, logos, and text also. Okay, whatever the text you are seeing on the screen is also a UI element. Okay, don't think that text is not a UI element. Even text is also a UI element. Now you understood what exactly the UI elements on the web pages are. So now we need to know why we need locators. So the purpose of the locators, first of all, what is the purpose of locators? The purpose of the locators is to locate UI elements. The purpose of the locators is to locate. So I am going to explain some locators concept. Okay, I have not given you any idea of what exactly the locators are, but at a high level, locators purpose is to locate the UI elements on the web page. So as we are seeing a lot of UI elements on this web page, okay, as we are seeing a lot of UI elements on this web page like buttons and all, if we have to find this button too, okay, out of all these UI elements on the web page, if we have to find this button too, then we have to use locators. But why we need locators? What is the main reason for using locators? Let me explain. Yes, that's fine. What is the main reason for using locators? The main reason here is Selenium is by default blind. Okay, that is Selenium doesn't have the ability to find or locate UI elements on the web page. Okay, Selenium is by default blind. For example, Selenium is somewhere here. Selenium means Selenium automation tool. Selenium is somewhere here, and let's say here we have the different UI elements on the web page. Okay, different UI elements on the web page. Can Selenium find directly? Can Selenium locate or find the UI elements directly, guys?
No,
it's not possible. Okay, by default it is not possible at all. Okay, Selenium doesn't have the inbuilt capability to locate the UI elements on the web page. This possibility is not there. Okay, it cannot locate. Selenium is blind. Here Selenium is blind. So what comes to the rescue, guys? What we have to use to make this kind of thing possible, because Selenium is by default blind, then what we have to use for making the Selenium locate the ULMans on the web page? What's the answer?
Locators.
Yes, simple, locators. So Selenium uses something known as locators. Selenium uses something known as locators. Fine. So locators are required for Selenium to locate the ULMans on the different ULMans on the web page. That's a basic concept. That's the reason, guys, we have to learn locators. Okay. The main reason for using or finding or learning about locators is that Selenium is by default blind. And in order to help Selenium locate the ULMans, we need locators. That's why locators will come in between. Here you can see the diagram, same diagram. Selenium uses locators to locate the ULMans on the web page. Fine. Cool. Now you know what exactly is the locators for and why we have to learn or use it in Selenium. Okay. Fine. Now let's move to the next item. That is, what are the different types of locators? Different types of locators. There are different types of locators which can be used for the purpose of locators. You already know is to locate the ULMans on the web page or help Selenium in locating the ULMans on the or find the ULMans on the web page. Fine. So what are the different types? So there are different ways of finding the ULMans on the web page because there are different types of locators. Okay, using these different types of locators, you can find the or locate the ULMans on the web page in different ways. That's possible. So there are multiple locator types. I'll tell you more about this different type of locators, why there are different type of locators and which one we have to use. Lot of things I have to explain. Okay, let's start with something like step by step. So first thing is, like, I have to explain what are the different types of locators for locating the ULMans on the web page. So we have the different type of locators like ID locator. Okay, ID locator. Then we have name locator. Different type of locators, guys. Then we have class name locator or class locator. Then we have link text locator or link locator. Then we have CSS selector locators. Then XPath expression locators. Then we have DOM locators. These are the different type of locators we have, guys. And out of all these things, this will be enough, guys. Okay, this will be enough. You don't have to learn the DOM locators. Okay, this is something that is there, but we generally don't use. So how many locator types you can see here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Total 7 locator types are there. 7 different type of locators. 7 different types of locators. So there may be some situations where you can locate the ULMans not only with ID but also with the class name. Okay, you are understanding, right? So here Selenium is there in between. Locators will be used and here ULMans are there. This is what we discussed. And for making the Selenium locate a particular or find the particular ULMans on the web page, so we need to, let's say we need to click on a button. We need to click on this button, let's say. I need to click on the button too. So in order to click on the button, Selenium will click on that. Okay, Selenium has the capability to click, but Selenium doesn't have the capability to find it. In order to click this button on this web page, the Selenium has to first locate or find this button, right? without finding or locating this button, Selenium cannot do anything. Selenium is by default blind. It cannot find the UI elements, but it can perform operations like click, enter text, like that. Okay. So let's say in this case of button, Selenium can click on this button, but Selenium cannot find this button. Then what it will do? Selenium will take the help of locators. But in case of locators, there are different type of locators. ID locator is there, name locator is there, class name locator is there, link text locator is there, CSS selector locators, XPath expression locators, DOM locators. This many number of locators are there. Which one I have to use? Which one Selenium need to use for locating the elements? That's the question.
Class name.
What is that? You can ping me on ping me so that I can. So what is the locator type we need to finalize? Yeah, come again. You can answer this question now. So if Selenium can use any of these locators, ID locator or class name locators, okay, to find the elements, which one Selenium will choose? Either Selenium can use ID locator or Selenium can use class name locator. Which one will be? Class name. Someone is saying class name. Okay. So the answer is wrong, guys. Okay, it's not correct. Okay, whatever you are saying in the chat is not correct. Okay, that's not correct. There is a priority. I will explain more about priorities. So, but at a high level, understand that Selenium can use any of these locators for locating the elements. Okay, either it can use ID locator or name or class name or link text or CSS, XPath, DOM. Anything it can use to locate the elements. But if multiple locator types can be used for locating the same element, that in order to locate this button, okay, we can either use ID or class name. In that case, which one we have to use? There is something known as priority. Okay, I'll explain. I will come to this topic again. Don't worry for now. Okay, don't worry about this priority concept. It will be covered here. Okay, in this part of the session, I'm going to cover the locator's priority, where if you can locate the same UI element with multiple locator types, then which locator type we have to use? Only one we can use at a time, right? So which one we have to finalize? That thing I will explain as part of the locator's priority. So we'll come to that again afterwards. But for now, now you understood what are the different types of locator types. These are the different ID, name, class name, link text, CSS selectors, XPath expressions, and DOM are the different type of locators available for us, which will help. All these locator types can help Selenium in finding or locating the UI elements. So what will happen if, let's say, Selenium with the help of locators has located this button? What can Selenium do after that? Can anyone? Once you are getting my point, right? Locators, we are using locators with Selenium to locate this button. Once the button got located, what can Selenium do on this particular button? What is the purpose? Like here, there are two things you have to understand. Locators for only helping the Selenium in locating. But what is the purpose of Selenium then? Guys, can anyone? This is very important. So yes, someone is pinging, like Krish is pinging, that it can perform operations on this button. Okay, so user clicks, all this kind of clicking on the button, okay, all these things, user operations on this button, reading the text from the button, everything can be done by Selenium. But Selenium is blind. It cannot perform, it cannot locate UI elements. But once it locates with the help of locators, it will perform the operations. Selenium generally perform the operations. Okay, whatever the person or a tester does on this button, the same thing can be done by the Selenium automation tool, like clicking the button if required. Okay, so that can be done by the Selenium. Fine. So another example let me give at a high level so that you will easily understand what I am saying. So I'll go to this page, let it open. Looks like it's not opening. Fine. So here we have another thing, similar thing. Here we have username, password, login. So generally, we as if you are before your system, you will enter some username and you will enter some password, okay? And once you enter, you click on the login button. Here there are two operations, right? In order to enter the username and password, Selenium has to first find this username field. Selenium has to first find this username field. How to find? How the Selenium will find, guys? How the Selenium will find this username text box field? Can anyone? With the help of what Selenium can find this username text box field? Yes, you are right. So everyone is pinging on the chat saying that Selenium uses locators to locate this text box field. That's fine. Once Selenium has used the locators for locating this text box field, what can Selenium do here after locating with the help of locators? What can Selenium do here? Yes, operation. That's fine. Yes, Selenium can enter the text into this text box field. Okay, that is Selenium will enter the username like this. What is the purpose of locating the element? Selenium want to perform some operations after locating. First, Selenium will step one is simple. Step one is step hash one. Selenium uses locators for finding the U element. This is the first step. The second step is after finding the U element, Selenium will perform any operation on the U element. Here in this case, Selenium will type text into this text box field. That is, type username into the text box field. Again, when coming to the password field, again Selenium has to find this password field. With the help of locator, Selenium will find this password field, and then Selenium will type the password after finding the like text box field using the locators. And once this username and password fields are typed or performed operation with the Selenium, what is the next action of the Selenium? Selenium has to find this login button, right? If you have to log in, Selenium has to find this login button. How? With the help of locators, it will find this login button. After locating or finding this login button, Selenium will click on this button. Okay, so like this, Selenium will click on the login button. This is how the things work, guys, in real time. Okay, so when you are going to automate using Selenium, we need locators to find the U elements. And once the Selenium uses locators to find the element, Selenium will perform the required operations on the required U elements. Fine. Hope you understood. Next thing is, so whatever the concepts I am going to explain about locators, right? For that, you need to have some basic idea of HTML. You don't have to learn HTML in detail now. Okay. So at least some basic idea of how the HTML works is enough. So in order to understand locators in a better way, first you need to have some basic understanding of how HTML works. So how many of you know HTML here already? You can ping me on chat, guys. So does anyone have any idea on HTML? What exactly is HTML? And yes, hypertext markup language. That's correct. You are like, yes, basic, Krish has basic knowledge. Anyone? What about others, guys? You can respond. It's a very simple question to answer. What about others? Does anyone know? Yeah, basic. Okay, that's good. Basic is enough. Okay, you don't have to have some extensive knowledge on HTML, but basic is enough. Anyhow, let me give some basic understanding of HTML in a simple way. I'll take you through the HTML basics. Why we are going through this HTML basics? Because having this kind of knowledge will help you in understanding the locators better. Okay, so we are going to practically use the locators. After explanation of this HTML basics, I am going to practically demonstrate the different type of locators. I am going to practically show you how you can use locators in Selenium. So for that, we need to have some knowledge of HTML basics. Then you will be able to do so. Fine. Let's start. The concept now is HTML basics. HTML basics for understanding locators is the topic. You don't have to learn HTML in detail, guys. Again, I am saying you don't have to learn HTML in detail. Whatever I'm going to explain will be enough. If you don't have any knowledge or idea about HTML, so whatever I'm trying to cover is enough for you to understand the locators. You don't have to learn HTML in detail after this. Fine. So we'll take a simple website. This is a website URL, guys. Let me copy and open here. Or you can even go from my this omaya.blogspot.com. Just scroll down here and you will find this link like compendium dev. Click on this link. It will take you to this basic web page. Fine. So here, this is a basic web page. As you can see on the screen, what is there on this web page? Can someone say what is there? What is displayed on this web page? Anyone? Yeah, someone has pinged me on chat saying that there is some paragraph. Okay, paragraph of text. That's correct. Paragraph is there. Okay, yes, paragraph is there. So there are two paragraphs actually. First paragraph and second paragraph with a very less amount of text. And apart from paragraphs, there is nothing here. Everything is blank. So this is a web page. From which area to which area? Let me draw something so that you can see. So this is a portion of the web page, right? This complete thing is a web page. And on this web page, only two UI elements are there. These two UI elements are nothing but the paragraph one and paragraph two. These two are the UI elements. Apart from these two UI elements, we don't have any other thing on this web page. Okay, we don't have any other things on this web page. Only two paragraphs are there. Very simple website. I intentionally took this simple website so that we can decode what is there. Now, how to find the HTML code of this web page? Can anyone say how to find the HTML code of this web page? I want to see the HTML code which is written for developing or designing this web page. Yes, yeah, someone is saying F12, someone is saying right click inspect. Okay, that's all correct. Okay, we can inspect. Simply right click on somewhere on this web page and select inspect option. Okay, then what you are getting? You are getting the here by default under the elements tab, we are getting the HTML code. This is one way, and other way is right click here and select view page source. This is another option. Okay, so either you have to say inspect under elements tab, you are getting this HTML code. Okay, by default it was coming like this, and other way is like right click here and select view page source, then the complete HTML code will be displayed here. Both the ways are possible. You can either right click inspect or right click view page source. So let me right click inspect so that it will be both the web page and HTML code will be displayed on the same page itself. Now under the elements tab, I can see the HTML code. So here you need to understand few things. Okay, you need to understand few things. Now let's decode it, guys. Okay, so here we have the web page and here we have the HTML code for this web page. Now let's decode the HTML code. So as you can see, this HTML code is starting with which tag? Can someone say what is the starting tag? As you can see the HTML code here like this. This is the complete HTML code. What is the starting tag? Starting tag is, okay, someone is saying header. Okay, so head tag. A lot of people are saying head tag, but the starting tag is not head tag. Is starting tag is HTML tag. So let's design something. Let's open the notepad. Yes, HTML is correct. Okay, HTML is correct. Head tag is not correct. So here I am opening a notepad intentionally, and at same time I am seeing the HTML code here. Here this particular web page is developed by writing some HTML code like this, where starting point is HTML. So this is HTML is a starting point. This is nothing but HTML tag, guys. So here, like this, it started with like this. Now at same time, can you tell me how this HTML code is ending? Using which tag the HTML code is ending? Can someone say? Okay. Yeah, Minal Patel and other like Anand, like Minal Patel and Sanjay were saying like slash HTML is correct. Okay, slash HTML is correct. Whatever they are saying is correct. So this is the ending tag. So here starting tag has only HTML, whereas ending tag has slash HTML. You should not forget slash, guys. Okay, ending is slash HTML. That's correct. So here slash HTML is the ending tag. This is the starting tag and this is the ending tag. Now next thing is inside this HTML starting tag and HTML ending tag, at a high level, now when I collapse the thing, at a high level, what do you see? What are the two tags you see inside this head and body? There are two tags under HTML. There are two tags. Yes, head and body are the two tags. So, and at same time, head is starting tag and head has ending tag. Body has starting tag, body has ending tag. So let's write down the same thing. I'm just decoding the same web page. Here we have head starting tag and head ending tag. Similarly, we have, you can even write it in separate lines like this. Okay, head starting tag, head ending tag, similar to HTML. This is outer box. Inside this HTML box, we have head box. Along with the head box, we have body tag. Okay, body tags, body starting tag, body ending tag, like this. That's fine. Now let's see more. Now I will expand the head tag, head starting and ending tag. What do you see inside this head? What do you see inside this head?
Title.
Yes, title tag is there. So again, title has the starting tag, title has the ending tag. So we have to write title. Title starting tag and title ending tag. Ending tag should have slash title. You have to say slash title. Fine. Next. So what about body? I'll expand the body now. In the body, what are there? How many tags are there in body? Can you see? Inside the body tag, two tags are there. What are they? Paragraph tags, P tags. There are two paragraph tags. So let me write down the paragraph tags. P slash P and P slash P. Like this, there are two tags. Fine. So now we got the structure of HTML is there. Okay. There is starting HTML tag and ending HTML tag at the end. And inside this HTML, we have head tags and body tags. And inside the head tag, we have title tag. Inside the body tag, we have the paragraph tag. So now I'll not give any title. I'll not give any paragraph text. Okay. I'll keep everything empty. I'll simply save this particular thing as a HTML document. So you need to save like this, guys. Okay. So if you don't have Notepad++, just download, guys. It's very easy to download Notepad++. Simply go to Notepad, just type Notepad++, and you'll get this link, download Notepad. From here, you need to download and install this Notepad++. Okay, very simple. So it's a very good tool to practice HTML. So here we have the HTML code. Now say file, save as. So before I am saying saving, before I am saving this particular text into my text box field, I can only see the normal like UI is not so much good, like plain text is there, right? Now here I will give something like a demo dot. Okay, I will say HTML demo, HTML demo dot HTML, I will say. Okay, HTML demo dot. You have to close this, otherwise you can simply say demo.html. That is also fine. .html is important, guys. You're seeing, right? While saving, I gave some name for this file as demo. Demo is the name of the file. and the extension of this file I am giving as HTML. Dot HTML is required. And then make sure that save as type is all types. Save as type is all types, and click on save. Immediately when I save it, what happened here? Can you see any difference? When I saved this file as a demo.html file with a proper extension, what happened in the Notepad++? Can you see any difference here, guys? Yes. So some kind of now this particular Notepad++ is identifying this HTML code. Okay. So additional operations came like this. Whatever we are seeing in this browser inspect options, right? The same thing came, right? This kind of functionality came into the Notepad++. So like this, you can expand, you can collapse, okay? All those things you can do. Now this looks good. At same time, how this particular file has been saved? This is the file it got saved. You can see this, right? Demo. It's a browser icon here. This is Edge browser, okay? By default in my machine, all my HTML files will be opened with the Edge browser. That's why Edge icon. In your system, if your default browser is Chrome browser, then this Chrome browser symbol will be displayed here for this file. Okay. In my case, default browser is Edge browser, so Edge browser icon is displayed here. So let me click on this demo file that I saved just now from this Notepad++. I saved some file into my desktop. It being saved like this. Double click or open it. So it will open, guys. The Edge browser has to open. So it's opening. It's taking some time. Let's wait. Yeah, it's opening. Yeah, fine. So it has opened. Do you see anything on the page? Do you see anything on the page, guys?
No.
Nothing is there. Yes, nothing is there. The reason here is, here in the HTML code, we didn't provide anything. Okay, this is just an outline we have given, but we have to enter something, right? But I'd also check the title. What is the title coming? What is the title, guys? Title of this page? Yeah, this is the title. What is the title? Demo.html is the title. Did I give any title here? In between the title tags, did I specify any title? No. Then what's coming? I didn't specify any title. Yes, I didn't specify any title. If you don't provide any title, by default it will take the file name. That is demo.html is a file name. Okay, by default it will take the file name demo.html. It will take. That's why here you see demo.html is coming. But if you want to give some proper title, so I have to go to this HTML code, and here between the titles I have to write something like Selenium Java training. Okay, training session hash 2. Okay, today I'm explaining about locators. I'm just giving the title like this. Okay, Selenium Java training session hash 2. We are discussing all about locators now. So now if I save this file and if I refresh this page, now what's the title? When I update the code and refresh this page file, demo.html. So what is the title you are getting? Selenium Java training session 2 locators is coming, right? So this is how we have to keep on working. Okay, we have to keep on working on the HTML code. Now few more things here. We have kept this is not compulsory. You can remove this also. Okay, so again refresh, nothing will be there here, nothing got displayed. But if I want to display some paragraph on the web page, okay, so here I will add a p tag and end it with a slash p, and here I will write something about okay, locators are used to find the UI elements on the web page. This is one paragraph I have written. Save this and go here. Now refresh the page. You see, a paragraph is getting displayed on the web page. Similarly, I can add one more paragraph. Selenium is by default blind and it uses locators for finding the UI elements on the web page slash p. You have to end with slash p. So another paragraph I added. Save this and refresh here. You see, the second paragraph is also displayed on the web page. So like this, you can keep on adding any number of paragraphs here. Okay, we can add any number of paragraphs. I'm adding the third paragraph. Okay, I'm adding the third paragraph. So after locating the UI elements, you are required locating the required UI element using Selenium, using locators. Selenium will perform operation on that UI element. Another paragraph I am adding. Save it, go here and refresh here. That's it. Okay, you got three paragraphs. Like this, we can add any number of paragraphs. So can we add any other things other than paragraph, guys? Can you give some examples of other things that I can add on the web page? Can you give something that we can add on the web page apart from the paragraphs? Yeah, headings are possible, title is possible. Okay, table we can add. Yes, lot of UI elements we can add. Buttons, checkbox options, radio buttons. Okay, lot of images. Yes, lot of things are possible. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to take few examples. So here, first thing is like I'll add some basic things. I'm not going to explain all the UI elements that you just ping me here, but I'm going to give you some basic examples of so that will be enough for understanding HTML. Okay, so adding the rulers means some lines. How to add ruler? There is something known as hr slash. So can you see any difference between paragraph tag and hr slash tag, guys? What is the difference between the paragraph tag and the hr slash tag? Anyone? Okay, the answer here is yes. Someone is yes, please answer. Okay, so the answer here is the paragraph tag is this starting tag is there. With paragraph tag we have the ending tag. Okay, p is a starting tag, this format is the ending tag. But in case of hr slash, we don't have a starting and ending. Okay, we only have, there are some HTML tags, guys, in HTML which doesn't need to end. Okay, they will start here and end there itself. For example, paragraph tag, it is starting here and ending here, and here also paragraph tag, it is starting here and ending here. But coming to hr slash, it's starting there itself and ending there itself. Okay, if a particular tag has to start and end there itself, we have to specify this kind of syntax, hr slash. Okay, so other example is like br slash, hr slash, like some kind of HTML tags are there which will start and end there itself. So what is the purpose of this hr slash? Why I added? If I save it and if I refresh here, you see a ruler is getting added to the web page. As you can see, right, a small line is coming here. So I'll repeat this. Okay, I'll copy this hr slash and paste it after this paragraph, first paragraph, and I'll try to do for everything. Okay, after every paragraph I'm pasting the hr slash, and if I save this and refresh, now you see, so simple rulers are coming after each and every paragraph. Okay, rulers are getting added like this. This is the purpose of the hr slash tag. So next thing is, now let's add a hyperlink. So far we added a UI element known as paragraphs. Okay, only paragraphs were added so far. Now let's add a hyperlink. How to add a hyperlink? So in order to add a hyperlink to the web page, we have a tag known as anchor tag. So that is a tag. You have to start with a and end with a. A tag is should be used for creating a hyperlink on the web page. So here, if I save something and refresh here. Did anything displayed here? Nothing, right? So we need to display something there. We need to display something there. So for that, let's say I will type some Google text. Anchor tag, ending anchor tag, in between there is some Google text. Now if I save and refresh here, the Google text is coming. Can I click on this? Is it an hyperlink? Guys, is it an hyperlink? No, we have to still create an hyperlink. Okay, by putting a text between the anchor text doesn't make it a hyperlink. We need to make a hyperlink. How to make? There is one concept known as attributes. Okay, we need to add some attributes, guys. In the starting tag, that is here, a tag is there. In the starting tag, just give some space here before closing the starting tag. Just give space, and here you can add some attributes. You are going to add attributes here. There is an attribute known as href attribute. Okay, href is equal to, this is a syntax, guys. Okay, this is a syntax. Href is equal to, here between the single quotes or double quotes, you need to provide some URL. Let's say I'll type Google here, and I will select this URL, copy from here, and go here and paste here. That's it. Okay. So https://www.google.com got pasted here. For href, this is a attribute, guys. Attribute name, and this is a attribute value. Attribute name and attribute value. Attribute value is nothing but the URL. So these are known as attributes, guys. In the HTML tags, here p tag is there. Here a tag is there. In this kind of tags, we can provide some attributes. This is first attribute. Attribute having attribute name and attribute value, like this. Fine. Now if I save this time and refresh here, you will be able to see hyperlink. Can I click now? Guys, can I click now? Yes, I can click now because I provided the href attribute for this anchor tag and I got the hyperlink. If I click on this, it is taking me to the Google page. But I have another requirement where I want to open this page. When I click on this, it should not open in the same page. It should open in a new tab. For that, we have another attribute. So here after this, inside the same a tag itself, only one attribute we have provided, right? So I'm going to create another attribute. We can create multiple attributes. Target attribute we can provide. This is a syntax of HTML. If you learn HTML, right, you will know all this stuff. You don't have to learn. Here you need to focus on what exactly are the attributes. HRF is one attribute, and HRF is the attribute name, whereas this URL is the attribute value. Okay. Coming to target is attribute name is equal to, again in the single quotes or double quotes, I have to give underscore blank. So when I give such kind of attribute, right, and save it, this time what will happen is when I refresh and when I click on this Google, this time it is opening in a new tab. That is the purpose of this particular target is equal to underscore blank attribute. Like this, HTML has tags, HTML has attributes for performing different things. You can achieve a lot of things with the help of these tags and attributes, guys, in HTML. Okay, so you need why I'm explaining this example is you need to understand the attributes, what exactly are the attributes and how you can add them to the tags is the main reason why I explained how to add hyperlink in this video session. Okay, fine. Then let's add a button. Button is a very common thing, right? Let's add a button. So how to add a button? So we have some tag like button tags. Okay, button slash button. So now save it and refresh the page. You got a button here. Actually, you can see some button is there here, guys. Okay, after Google link, there's some button here. But can you see anything on the button? Sorry, where is that? Yeah, here. So can you see button, guys? After Google link, can you see any button? Very small, right? So, but there is no text on this button. That's why the button is very small. As you can see on the screen, the button has been created actually, but since there is no text, it's being looking blank. So we need to add some text here. Say I will add some text like click here, okay, text, and save this and refresh here. You see, now we got the button known as click here button. Click here button we got. So what will happen when you click on this button? Nothing will happen, okay? Here when I click on this button, the button is clickable, guys, nothing will happen. In real time we can write lot of code here to make this button work, but that's not required for us to learn anyhow. Fine, this is how we have to write the button, guys. And there is something known as developers while writing such kind of creating such kind of UI elements, right? What they will do is they will add some ID kind of locators, okay, ID kind of attributes. ID is equal to button one, something they will add. Why they are adding, guys? Why that, can anyone say why the ID is equal to button one is getting added for this particular button? Can someone guess why this is being added by developers? Anyone? Yes, there may be multiple buttons on the page, that is also correct. So again, another button may be there like this, okay, try this button. Yes, try this button, okay. So out of all the buttons or out of all the UI elements, if a developer want to uniquely identify something, they need to add this kind of attributes like ID is equal to button one, here ID is equal to button two. Uniquely identify something, they may add some kind of attributes like ID attributes like this, okay. So developers will generally add this kind of things, and when they add, we are going to use them as locators afterwards, okay? So these are very required for us to understand, because in locators we need to use this kind of ID attributes. So when I save this and refresh here, we'll get two buttons: click here button, which has ID as button one; try this button, which has ID as button two. So developers, in order to identify these buttons, okay, uniquely, or locate these buttons for their own purpose, they will be adding this kind of ID attribute names and values, okay? ID attributes they will be adding, that's the purpose. Fine, now let's the creation is done, guys. Whatever I wanted to show, right, on HTML, how the things work and all, as part of locators I completed, but let me inspect some UI elements so that you will learn from that. For example, here let's go to omaya.blogspot.com, where I have a lot of UI elements on this web page. So let me demonstrate different things. Let me inspect this radio buttons and drop down options. For different reasons I am doing this thing. So first thing is let me inspect the radio button. So here you can see the mail radio button. Right click here and select inspect option. When I say right click inspect option, so what's coming here? I just inspected this radio button, okay, mail radio button inspect. I got this this particular line got highlighted here. As you can see, some blue line is there here, right? I'm just moving my mouse here and there, that particular line where a blue line is there, okay? This line belongs to this radio button, okay? When I inspect this, this line is getting highlighted. When I hover the mouse on this line, you can see on the UI above, guys, you see the mail radio button is selected, I mean it's highlighted. That means this HTML code belongs to this radio button. This is the indication, guys. Now tell me, what are the different attributes you are seeing here for this particular input tag of this radio button? Can someone say what are the different attributes you are seeing on this HTML code? Guys, you can ping me on the chat or you can speak, whatever is fine for you. So yes, yes, type attribute is there, name attribute is there, ID attribute, ID is also there, guys, okay? ID is also there, ID attribute is there, value attribute is there, and each and every attribute has some values. ID is equal to value, type is equal to radio, I mean type is a attribute name, radio is a value of that attribute, name is a attribute name, gender is a value for that attribute, value is a attribute name, mail is a value for that attributes. So like that, there are total four attributes in this input tag, which is starting here. There are four attributes with some values, right? So here you see name is equal to gender is there, okay? And we have another radio button. If I inspect this radio button, here also there are four. How many attributes are there? Four attributes are there. ID is equal to radio 2, type is equal to radio, name is equal to gender, value is equal to female. Can you see any difference, any similarity between this this tag and this tag? Is there any similarity between the attributes of this this tag and this tag, guys? Here, name. Okay, let me explain. Here we have name as gender. Here also we have name as gender. Both are common. Same thing, right? Repeated. Why? Why it is repeated? Here, ID and ID is different. ID is equal to radio 1, ID is equal to radio 2 are different, right? This ID attributes are different, unique. ID has to be unique every time. ID has to be unique. ID should be unique. Should be unique. If ID is not unique, right? If ID is not unique, that is not a good way of, okay? It's possible that sometimes developers do some mistakes by keeping the ID as duplicate. That's not a correct thing, guys. ID should be unique. And coming to the names, names can have to be unique or they can be same also. There is nothing like name have to be unique, okay? So name can be duplicated. Name can be duplicated. That means here name is equal to gender is there for one radio, male radio option, this radio option, the name is gender, and this radio option also, the name is gender. Both are same. Okay, that's okay. That's correct also, because these two radio options belong to the same functionality. They are together. We have to group them, right? So as part of HTML, the developer has to group these two radio buttons into the same category. That's why he added name is equal to gender, name is equal to gender. That's correct, guys. So what is correct, what is wrong? We need to understand. Here, ID should be unique. It should not be duplicated. Where name can be unique, if this particular two fields belong to the same functionality, then they can have the same name. Similar thing, let me explain. I will give another example here. Here we have book, pen, book, laptop, bag. Okay, let me inspect something here. So how many checkbox options are there here, guys? How many checkbox options?
Four.
Yes, four are there. So when I inspect one of the checkbox option, and as you can see, this is the first checkbox option, this is the second checkbox, this is the third, this is the fourth, right? These are the HTML lines of code for these four checkbox options. Can you see the name similarities? Can you see the name similarities, name attribute similarities for the four checkboxes in this HTML code? Here is the HTML code. You can say, you can focus on this HTML code here. Let me draw this portion. So 1 minute. Let me draw this part. You can see this, right? I highlighted it. Pen, book, laptop, bag. Okay. Yes. Accessories. Same name is provided multiple times, because all these four checkbox options belong to the same category. That's why the name also will be same. But ID is not there. It's not compulsory that every UI element should have an ID. Here ID is not specified by the developer. That's fine. That's also good. Fine. Now you understood something, right? Then we'll go to the next UI element, that is drop down options. So here there is a drop down field. Here there is a drop down field. Right click, inspect this drop down. So I just inspected this drop down field, guys. So here we have ID attribute and ID value, class attribute and class value, name attribute. Here three attributes are there. ID is there, name is there, class is there. Three attributes. Okay. So something new for is class here. Okay. This class attribute is something new for us. Apart from having the ID and name attributes, this time this particular UI element is also having the class attributes. This you have to know, guys. Okay, class attribute is something generally we can see here and there. Next thing is image. Images will have the SRC attribute. Okay, generally images will have the SRC attribute. Let me inspect an image. Right click on this image and select inspect option. So this is a HTML code for this image. And what is the attribute we have? SRC. Source. Okay, this is the URL from which this particular image is loading. So, okay, this is the copy link address. Let's see whether I can get that. Yes, image. This is the image that is getting loaded on this web page. In the source attribute, I am providing the URL of the image from where the image tag has to load the image on this web page. That's the purpose of the source. And apart from that, we have other attributes like height, weight. Okay, height, weight, any other things. That's it. Height and weight. Height of the image, weight of the image, like that. Many other attributes will exist, guys. And now the next one is text area field. Text area field. So here I'll inspect this text area field. Right click inspect. And there is some HTML code highlighted for this particular text area field. So can you see different attributes here? ID attribute is there that we already seen. Rows, columns, content, editable, true. Like that, some random attributes can also be there. Okay, rows, columns, anything can happen, guys. Okay, lot of HTML tags are there here, and they have different type of attributes. They will have different type of attributes. It's not compulsory that you should only have the ID, name, class. Okay, we can have some random attribute names like rows, columns, and other stuff. So now, guys, this is all enough for HTML basics. Okay, this knowledge is enough for your understanding of the locators. This knowledge of HTML basics is enough. Okay, so any questions or doubts, guys, you have on whatever I explained so far about HTML basics? Is it clear for you? Is HTML basics concept clear for you, guys? Yes, cool, great, fine. So let me go to the next topic now. It's very simple, guys. Whatever I'm going to do is like, it's not theoretical, it's going to be practical. You can easily understand now. Okay, what I am going to say is very simple and easy to understand, because you understood all the theoretical concepts. Now it's very easy to understand the practical concepts. So let me, so for that I have to demonstrate different type of locators, how the locators work. I have to say here, I was saying like here we have Selenium. Here we have the ULements on the web page. Here we have the ULements on the web page. And in between, we are going to use locators. This is a concept. Selenium, with the help of locators, will locate the required ULement. This is a concept. So how to practically demonstrate this stuff? How can I show you that Selenium, with the help of locators, can locate the ULements? That's where I am taking you. Okay, in this section I am going to practically demonstrate how the locators are going to help Selenium in locating the ULements. But there is a problem. That is, here Selenium, if I talk about Selenium, there are different components, right? There is Selenium ID is there, Selenium WebDriver is there. Okay, different components are there. Our focus should be on Selenium WebDriver, but since we have not started, okay, since we have not started learning the different commands of Selenium WebDriver, it will be difficult for me to demonstrate this locators with Selenium WebDriver. Actual case, I have to use Selenium WebDriver. I have to make use of Selenium WebDriver to demonstrate how to use locators for locating the ULements. But that is not possible right now because we are not there, right? Selenium WebDriver, if you have to go right, we have to even complete Java also. Okay, we have to even cover Java. After covering Java, we can go to Selenium WebDriver. Then only we can go to Selenium WebDriver. Since it will take some time for us to like learn Java and go to the Selenium WebDriver, I cannot use Selenium WebDriver as example for using locators and locating the ULements. That is not possible in this session. So what is possible is, instead, I am going to use some tool known as Selenium ID. Okay, another component of Selenium, which we generally don't use, but here, as with respect to this topic, we can actually use it. Just assume that Selenium ID is Selenium for a while. Okay, just assume that Selenium ID is a Selenium for a while and see how Selenium ID or Selenium can locate the ULements using the locators. That's what I'm going to practically demonstrate, guys. Since I cannot explain using WebDriver, I am going to use Selenium IDE in this session. So in order to use Selenium IDE, we have to install Selenium IDE first. Okay, install Selenium IDE in any browser, then only we can use Selenium IDE. So let me take something here. Open, okay, open any browser, say Chrome. Search Selenium, search for Selenium IDE, guys. Search for Selenium IDE and you will get the search results, selenium.dev, official website of Selenium, and you will get Selenium IDE. Okay, Selenium IDE you will get. You need to click on this link, guys. Selenium IDE open source record and playback tool. Click on this link and you will be taken to selenium.dev/selenium-ide page, where you will see these options: how to install Selenium IDE in Chrome browser, how to install Selenium IDE in Firefox browser. Like that, only two browsers are supported, Chrome and Firefox. Okay, Selenium IDE can be installed in Chrome and Firefox. Since I am on Chrome browser, I'll select Chrome download. Click on the Chrome download link. This is the process for installing Selenium IDE in your machine, guys. You don't have to learn Selenium IDE in detail, guys. Okay, it's not required for us, but since in our case I need to use Selenium for locating the UI elements using the help of locators, I have to demonstrate this topic. That's the reason I am trying to install Selenium IDE. Click on Add to Chrome and you will get this dialog, Add Selenium IDE, where you need to click on Add Extension. So after a while you'll get this dialog saying that Selenium IDE has been added successfully to Chrome. Okay, so you can close it. And you can see some icon here, add-on icon, Selenium IDE. When I hover, you see Selenium IDE add-on icon is coming. It's better after installing any add-ons, right? Just close everything and open the browser again. And yeah, the Selenium IDE is still there. Okay, Selenium IDE is still there. Now again, go to the website where you have all the UI elements. Copy this URL, guys. Copy this URL and fine. Now click on Selenium IDE, click on Selenium IDE, select this create a new project. Just follow these steps, guys. These steps will help me in demonstrating this different locators for you. It will not take so much of time. Okay, it is very easy. So simply what I am saying, just click on the Selenium IDE while this page is open. Click on Selenium IDE, click on create a new project, give some project name, say Selenium locators, some demo project name I am giving, and say okay. This kind of screen will come, and here select any row like this. Select any row, and when this row is selected, you will see this command, target, value, description kind of fields here. Open this command and select any option, guys. Okay, anything, just select, let's say select click. Okay, any option you have to select. If I don't select, what will happen is, let me show you. If I don't select this command, these options are not getting enabled. Okay, you see this option, these two options, select target in page, find target in page, these two options are getting disabled here, right? But once I select any option here, let's say click option, you see they got enabled. This is the purpose we have to select this. Some command we have to select in the drop down of Selenium IDE. Then here, so here the locators examples are there. I said there are different type of locators, right? ID locator, name locator, class locator, link locator, CSS locator, XPath locator, and DOM locator. So for ID locator, let's say here, right click on this button to inspect. And this is the HTML code for this button, which has ID attribute. As you can see, we have ID attribute here. ID is equal to button 2. Okay, ID is equal to but2 is there here. This thing we are going to use as a locator, guys. Okay, this ID attribute we are going to use as a locator. How to use, let me explain. So this particular ID is equal to but2, just type it here, simple. ID is equal to but2. This attribute name and value, just type into this target box field of Selenium IDE. Now click on this search icon, that is find target in page. So can you see something happening, guys? What's happening here? This is the locator, guys. This is nothing but locator. So, and this is a UI element. What is a UI element? Okay, 1 minute. Let me draw properly. So this is a UI element. This button is a UI element. Now, where is Selenium? Guys, where is Selenium then? Yeah. This is nothing but Selenium. Okay. This Selenium ID, whatever you are saying is a Selenium. Selenium cannot directly locate the UI elements. Selenium will take the help of these locators to locate this UI element. This is what is happening internally. Okay. This is what is happening internally. So yes. So Selenium is taking the help of locators to locate the UI elements. So to confirm whether the Selenium is able to locate this particular UI element with the help of this locator, how to confirm that? There is a button given by the Selenium ID tool. When you click on the search button, you see if it is getting highlighted, you are seeing something, right? A kind of just observe this UI element. When I click on the search button, you'll see some kind of gray out kind of thing will come, pop up and then go away. You see this kind of thing. Okay. That means this button is getting highlighted and located. That is the way to confirm, guys. Okay. Whether the given ID locator is working or not. Next, name locator. So there is something here, this text box field. Let me go to the text box field, locate using a name. Okay. Inspect this text box field. This example here, you see name is equal to some text box. N is there. Now here, if I give, instead of ID is called BUT2, if I give this name is equal to, just copy this. If you want, you can even individually copy, right click, copy and paste into the name is equal to text box N. And if I click on the search icon, what's getting highlighted this time? Can you see anything getting highlighted, guys? What is highlighting when I click on this? Can you ping me? Just confirm what is highlighting from your side. What you can see is getting highlighted, guys.
Locator using name attribute is highlighting.
Yes, that means we have used name locator for locating this text box field. Selenium is using the help of the name locator to locate this text box field. That is what is happening. Okay, so we have located a UI element with the help of ID locator already. This is the syntax. ID is equal to some value. Already name locator is also demonstrated to you. Name is equal to some text box N. Then class locator. Coming to class locator, the syntax is here. There is a field, you see, locate using class. Inspect this. Class is equal to class 1. Now here we have to use class is equal to class value. But here, guys, there is a problem. Selenium ID cannot locate something using class. Okay. Selenium ID doesn't has the capability to use class locators. This is correct. Locator is correct, but Selenium generally don't support. Selenium ID doesn't support class locators. Here, what is there? Class is equal to class 1. You can see that in action. This will not work. Even though this locator is correct, if I even click, it will not work, guys. The problem here is Selenium ID is not supporting this class locator. But coming to Selenium WebDriver, okay. So here Selenium ID is not supporting the class locator, whereas Selenium WebDriver will locate, will support it. But since we are not ready with Selenium WebDriver, I will explain this class locator and how to use it for locating the elements with Selenium WebDriver. Okay. During the upcoming Selenium WebDriver sessions, I will practically demonstrate this class locator. But for now, since we are using Selenium ID for locating the UI elements with the help of locators, I cannot demonstrate the class locator. Only ID and name and remaining locators I can demonstrate. Next thing, link locator. Let's use link locator. As you can see some link here, there is any link here. Yeah, compendium dev link. Okay, right click on this hyperlink and select inspect. So there is some text between the anchor text. What is the text, guys? Can you see any HTML code here for this URL? Do you see any HTML code here? And can you see any text between the text, anchor text? What is the text between the anchor text? Guys, what is the text that you can see on the page? HTML code, the text between the anchor text. Can someone ping? What is the text that you can see? Yes, Krish has pinged compendium div. Yes, this is correct. This is our text, guys. Okay, you can copy this text. The text between the, this is a starting tag, this is ending tag. In between that, some text is there. Copy that text and go to the Selenium IDE and type here link, L-I-N-K, link is equal to, and paste the text between the anchor tags. So this will become the link text locator. This will become the link text locator. Selenium IDE can also use the link text locator for locating this particular link locators, link UI elements. Click on this, you see what is getting highlighted? This hyperlink is getting highlighted. Okay, this is a link locator. Similarly, we have CSS selector locators. So there is some syntax here you can see, right? CSS is equal to hash but2. Okay, so you don't know what exactly is there, right? But just copy it blindly for now. Okay, how to generate, I will explain in the later point of the session. I'll explain how to generate this CSS selector. Copy this, simply copy this, go to Selenium IDE, just type CSS is equal to, just type the same thing. Okay, CSS is equal to, this is a CSS, this part is a CSS selector, guys. Okay, hash but2 is a CSS selector, and this is a syntax. CSS is equal to CSS selector you have to give. And how to create the CSS selector? Don't worry about that now. I will explain you how to auto generate the CSS selector in the coming session, this part. So now using the CSS selectors locators, can we locate the UI elements or not? Can Selenium IDE use the CSS selectors locator to locate the UI elements? So click on this, you see button 2. That means this is a CSS selector of which button? Button 2. Okay, CSS selector of button 2. Similarly, other locator we have is XPath locator. We have XPath locator, guys. So this is a XPath locator. Copy this. Even XPath locator we can auto generate, guys. I will show you how to auto generate the XPath locators afterwards. Okay, for now blindly copy paste into this Selenium IDE. The syntax is XPath is equal to, this part is the XPath expression. Okay, how to create this XPath expression? I'll let you know. Okay, just for a while, just ignore how to, just blindly copy paste. Okay, for a while to understand, for understanding purpose, just copy paste. So XPath is equal to, like this I am saying, and here, okay, let, this is hiding me, fine. So click on search button, you see the same button is getting highlighted. The same button is getting highlighted, button 2. This is a XPath expression or XPath locator for locating the button 2 only. Okay, Selenium IDE is supporting that. Next thing, DOM locator. We don't have to even learn DOM locator, guys, but just to give an example, I just wrote it. Even DOM locator is not supported by Selenium IDE. So here already I told you class locator is not supported by Selenium IDE, so I cannot demonstrate that for you. I have to wait for Selenium WebDriver sessions. There only I can demonstrate. Similarly, DOM locator also same thing, but there is a way, guys. I can use this DOM locator for making it locate some UI elements, but I am not going to use Selenium IDE. I'm going to use a different thing here. Okay, I have to go to console, clear this stuff, go to console, guys. Just see what I am doing. From elements tab, I went to the console tab. If any text you see here, click on this clear console, you will get this kind of command prompt kind of thing. Okay, here type the same thing. Okay, so here copy and paste, guys. You don't have to learn DOM at all. Okay, so no need to learn DOM locators. So there is a complete language on this DOM. You don't have to learn it. So copy and paste it here. DOM is equal to document.getElementById. but2 is a syntax. Press enter. What's the result, guys? I'm getting some HTML code. When I hover the mouse, you see which is getting located. When I hover the mouse on this HTML code, the button 2 is getting located. You see, this is how we can make sure whether DOM is able to locate a UI element or not. Okay, Selenium IDE can use DOM locator to locate the UI elements. With the help of DOM locators also, Selenium can locate the elements. So guys, this is how the locators works. Okay. So I practically demonstrate all the different type of locators using Selenium IDE and the basic console tab for now. Only one thing that is pending is a class locator, which I will be covering in the Selenium WebDriver sessions. Fine. So now the next thing is locator priority. Now guys, if you see here, we have located multiple things. I mean, same U element. Let's say button 2 is there. In the practical demonstrations of different locators have shown you by using Selenium IDE or browser console, right? So the same button 2 here, whatever the button 2 you are seeing here, using how many locators I was able to locate the same button? Can someone say that? I demonstrated this locating this button 2. Out of all the locator types, how many different locators have used for locating the same button on the web page? Can someone say? Guys, just someone reply on the chat. Which locators I have used? That is the list of all locators, but I have not used this for name. For name locator, I demonstrated only this. I just located only this text box field. This particular locate using name. This one I used name locator, but I'm talking about only button 2. Which locators I have used for locating the button 2? Only button 2. Yes, ID is correct. Sonu Patel, whatever you said, ID is correct. I have used ID locator for locating the button 2 in this examples, practical demonstration. Apart from ID, what did I used? Just now I used, right? Three different locators I used at the end of the locator practical demonstrations. What are they? Using ID, we can locate. Simple. ID is equal to BUT2. Okay. And click on search. You see, button 2 is getting located. Another example I have used is XPath. XPath is equal to, this is the syntax I have to take. XPath is equal to, just copy paste here. Run this. You see, the same button is getting located. Similarly, I have used CSS selector also. Okay. Yes. CSS also I used. Correct. CSS. And this is also locating the same button. Now DOM also used. I am pasting it here and it will not work here. Okay, this will not work here. So I have to go to console and then use it. Okay, as I told here. Here like this console and press enter. Over, you see button 2. So I can use either ID locator or I can use XPath CSS locators. Or I can use XPath expression locators, or I can use DOM locators. In this example, in the practical demonstrations I have given, I have used this many number of locators for locating this button, same button, but different locators. Either I can locate using this, or this, or this, or this. But only one is required, right? Can we use 4 at a time, guys? Can we use 4 at a time for locating the button? Is it possible?
No.
Yes, it's not possible at all, right? So we should not be using, we cannot be using 4 locators at a time to locate a particular button. So only one we have to select out of these things. Only one locator we have to select out of all these available locators. Okay. And we have to select the best. Okay. Available best version we have to select. Best one we have to select. Okay. So how to decide the best of these 4 things? We have to learn about priority now. Okay. Priority of locators is required for us to decide which one we have to choose for locating this particular button. When multiple possibilities are there, we have to only choose one possibility, which is the best possibility. For that, we have to know what is the priority of these locators. This is where priority of locators will come into picture. I'm going to explain that. What is the priority of different types of locators we can use for locating the elements? So here, very simple guys, this diagram gives you the what is priority wise. This diagram is designed according to the priority, guys. As you can see, ID has the first priority. Okay, let me write down. So first priority. Then name has a second priority. Then class name has a third priority. Link text has a fourth priority. CSS selectors, fifth priority. You have to remember this, okay? Sixth priority. Then finally, generally this kind of case will not come, guys. I have never seen someone using DOM locator, okay? Very rare you will be using the DOM locators. Seventh priority, like this. First, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh. So if you have this here, now based on these priorities, guys, tell me, based on these priorities, tell me if IMB will be able to locate button 2, okay? If I will be able to locate button 2 with the help of ID, CSS, XPath, DOM, which one you will choose, guys? Based on this priority, which one you will choose?
ID.
Yes, ID should be given the first priority. Okay, simply follow the priority, guys. Now you know what are the priorities, right? You need to apply the priorities. And if you can locate a single element with multiple locator types, then you can decide the priority based on this diagram. Okay, simple. So give priority to ID. If ID is not there, then you will choose name. If name is not there, then you will try with class name. If class name is not there, you will go with link text, like that. Okay, you have to go with the priority. What is the best priority possible? You have to take care of that. Now you understood what is priority also. So the last part left for today's session, guys, that is, here I was saying, you understood everything because you know how to create this ID locator from the HTML code. You now know how to create this name locator from the HTML code of a particular element by inspecting the right U elements. We can create this kind of locators. It's very easy. Class is equal to class value and link is equal to link text. You know all these things. But coming to this XPath expressions and CSS selectors, it's a bit problem. Okay, DOM anyhow we are not going to use anywhere. That's fine, you can ignore this. But coming to CSS selectors and XPath expressions, how to create such kind of expressions here? CSS is equal to BUT2 or XPath is equal to. So there is some tool, guys, okay, to auto-generate this kind of XPath expressions and CSS selectors. We have a tool. The tool is nothing but CrowPath. It's a very good tool in the market. Okay. So CrowPath is a tool. We have to create this CrowPath, install this CrowPath tool. It's a browser add-on. The way we installed Selenium IDE browser add-on, a similar way, we can also add CrowPath as a browser add-on, okay? Browser extension or add-on for auto-generating the XPath expressions and CSS selectors for us. So let me practically show you how you can use CrowPath, okay? For creating this kind of XPath expression locators and CSS selector locators for us. So CrowPath is very good and it's very powerful. It actually creates this best version of XPath expressions and CSS selectors, okay? It thinks a lot and then creates a very good XPath expressions and CSS selectors. Fine. So let me show you how you can use CrowPath for auto-generating this XPath expressions and CSS selectors for us. So open any browser and here search CrowPath. Okay, just search CrowPath, guys. So CrowPath, and you can go to here, that's fine, but at same time you see something like autonomiq.io CrowPath page, right? The free XPath and CSS selector thing. Just click on this page. This is the official website of the CrowPath, guys. Okay, autonomiq.io/CrowPath is a page. You have to go. After going here, so now you see CrowPath can be installed in, this particular add-on can be installed in different browsers. Okay, Chrome browser you can install, Firefox browser you can install, Edge browser you can install, Opera browser you can install. These are the four supported browsers. A lot of people use these browsers, guys. Okay, so you can install this CrowPath in any of these browsers. I prefer installing CrowPath in Chrome browser. So I will download this for Chrome browser. Let's see, for now you see there is no icon for CrowPath here on the top of the browser. Once I click on this download CrowPath, I'll be taken to this chrome.google.com chrome store where I can see this CrowPath, and I need to select this add to Chrome, and I will get this dialog where I need to select this add extension. When I do so, the crow path will be added. You see, the crow path got added, guys. Crow path has been added to Chrome. So it's asking, and also you need to, like, once you install any add-on, right? So you need to close the browsers and open again. Okay, just it's a good practice to, after installing any add-on in the browsers, you have to restart the browser. It's a good practice. So go to this omaya.blogspot.com page. Now you see crow path icon is there. That means crow path is successfully added. But how to use this crow path for auto generating the XPath expressions and CSS selector locators? How to use it? Let me explain. It's very simple. After you have this crow path installed, let's say I would like to find the XPath expression of this button. Okay, I would like to find the XPath expression of this button too. So right click on this button, select inspect option. Then you will get this dev options of the default dev options of the Chrome browser like this. Right click inspect. So by default elements tab is selected here. That's fine. On the right side, when this elements tab is selected, the sub tags are there. Sub tabs like styles, computed, event listeners are there, right? These three tabs are displayed here. If you expand, more tabs will be displayed. So if your thing is like collapsed, here you see this two arrows, right? Click on these two arrows. Here you will see this crow path. Okay, this is a place where after installing this crow path add-on, you will get the crow path here. You need to go to here, guys. Okay, so you can drag it if you want to see the complete UI of this crow path. Okay, so crow path need to be selected from here. Now right click inspect. So what's happening? Crow path is automatically, this is the functionality of crow path. It's automatically generating the CSS selector for you. So this is the CSS selector. Right click copy, or you can click on this edit and you'll get it here and you can copy. Okay, as you can see, it's already locating. You see this button is highlighted already. This CSS selector can be used for, you can even select this. Okay, if you select CSS selector, only CSS selector option will be displayed. If you select relative XPath, only relative XPath will be displayed. Okay, this is XPath expression. So guys, here you see absolute XPath is there. Okay, this is absolute XPath. Absolute XPath means complete path, starting from HTML. HTML is the first tag, right? Then so on to the required element. You don't have to use, you should not be using absolute XPath. You should be generally using relative XPath. Just say relative XPath, and this will be filtered here. And click on this edit icon. So you will see the relative XPath here. You have to use relative XPath and CSS selector only. Okay, relative CSS selector and relative XPath only. Okay, you should not be using absolute. Ignore this absolute XPath, guys. This is not recommended. Okay, there is a lot of problem if you use absolute XPath. So sometimes absolute XPath will fail. It will fail in identifying the locators. Okay, but relative XPath is very good. It is dynamic and it's very good. It actually locates very effectively. And also CSS selector, anything you can use. You see how to auto generate. Now you understood, right? How to auto generate the XPath? Copy here. Okay. So which part, Shivam, you are saying, which part you want me to show? Crow path. Okay. So as you know, we have installed crow path, right? Till installation of crow path, is it clear? Installation of crow path, is it clear? Yes. Okay. Then after installing, right click anything. Let's say the button is there here. Okay. Right click on this button. Select inspect. Simple. Select inspect. When you select inspect, this dev tools options will come, right? Chrome dev tools. Is it clear so far? Is it clear so far? Yes. Okay. Now, when the elements tab is selected here, you need to, you can see the styles, computed, event listener, DOM breaks, like that some sub tabs are coming. Okay. Sub tabs are coming. So you need to click on this two arrows here so that you can see multiple other options. Either or you can click on this, or you can do one more thing. What you can do is you can expand like this completely. Then only you can see, right? Some tabs will be hidden because of the space constraints here. So the last tab will be crow path. That's why we have to click on this two arrows. And we need to select this crow path option. Then the crow path functionality will come. Clear so far? Is it clear so far? Yes. Okay. So now once the crow path is selected, you can inspect anything. Inspect here, right click and inspect here. Automatically these things will be generated for you. Okay, you don't have to do. And you can, if you want to filter this, here you see a lot of options are there. Relate XPath is there, ID is coming, CSS selector is coming, absolute XPath is coming. I can filter the CSS selector like this. When I filter CSS selector, out of all the four possible locators identified by the crow path, okay, CSS selector will be filtered. If your requirement is CSS selector, you can filter CSS selector here and you can click on this edit icon and you'll get this CSS selector. Copy from here. That's it. This is the CSS selector. Now go to Selenium ID and put CSS is equal to paste it here. That's it. Okay. This is the CSS selector, guys. Now click on search button. Could not find CSS is equal to hash button on page. Maybe I need to close and because I left the session, right? Let me again launch Selenium ID. Sometimes it happens. Okay. Okay. Let me open and select some command. And here say CSS is equal to paste it again. Okay. I'm just pasting this CSS selector. And click on search. You see, it's locating. Selenium ID is able to locate this particular button with the help of the CSS selector, which got auto generated by this crow path. Okay. Similarly, XPath expression. You should not select absolute XPath. You have to select relative XPath only. Okay. So it's saying no tab is available for this test case. Where exactly? I didn't get you, Shivam. Can you explain more? Okay. For you or for me, you are saying. Here I'm not seeing. Okay. Okay, we'll sort it out. Okay, so let's switch to Shivam's screen. Can you share your screen? Is it possible, Shivam, to share your screen?
I won't be able to share my screen because I'm doing off a different laptop.
Okay, fine. I think you can try this. It will work actually. Or you can paste something, or how to do it then, if you are not able to share the screen.
Yeah, I did open a Chrome tab.
Okay. So, did you went up to here? You can see crow path here already?
Yeah, I saw that part.
Okay, then did you inspect any element already?
Yeah.
So, what's coming there?
The button ID, button to eat and type, and then content edible true XPath 1 button 2, and then I went on rel XPath and I copied, and I was trying to paste it
into Selenium ID.
Yeah, with command.
Does it look similar to this one, whatever you're seeing on the screen?
Yeah,
that's it. You copied XPath.
Yeah.
Okay, let me copy the same XPath. So copy. You have to say XPath is equal to, okay? You should not say CSS is equal to here. You have to say XPath is equal to. Did you say the same thing?
Oh, no, I didn't write XPath.
Yeah, that's the difference. So when you are using relative XPath, you have to say XPath is equal to. When you are using CSS, okay? When you are using CSS, okay? Then you have to say CSS is equal to. That's important, okay? That's the syntax.
Okay.
Then only it can locate. Just see if it is working now.
No, it's not locating it.
You can restart the Selenium ID and try again.
Okay.
So sometimes what happens is, like, after you install Crow Path, right, you have restarted your browser. So the connection between the Selenium ID and Chrome browser will be lost. Okay. So better launch the Selenium ID again and try the same steps. This will work for sure.
Okay.
Just try it. Your site.
Yeah.
So what about others, guys? Do you want to try it, or you can even try it, what Shivam is doing? It worked for you. Okay, it works fine. Great. Shivam has pinged that it is working now. So that's it, guys. Anyone?
Yeah, it's not getting in my computer also. Selenium ID.
What thing you typed into the target field then?
From beginning only, I'm not getting.
Oh, okay. So is it possible to share your screen? Do you have the possibility of sharing your screen? I can give you an option so that you can share your screen if you want.
Yeah, 1 minute.
Did you restart the Selenium ID as I said?
Yes, I restarted my Selenium ID.
Okay, so did you type anything? So did you type the command? Did you select any command into the Selenium ID already?
No, I have not.
You have to enter the command, because without this command, right, these things will not work. Okay, so you have to first select some command. So I choose the click command, as you can see here, right? Into the command, you have to say click.
Yeah, just so from the beginning. Just close all the Selenium, just so from the beginning.
Okay, just close everything. That's fine.
Yeah.
I just closed it. Now, we know here which one you are using, really, XPath expression or CSS selector?
No. I'm sharing my screen so you will understand.
Okay, so. 1 minute.
Disabled.
Yes, it will be disabled. So 1 minute. I have to give you some permissions so that you can do that. I'm not seeing anything. So, one minute. Can you share it now? You will be able to do so now. Try to share the screen now.
Yeah.
Yes, Kiran Patel, right? Yeah, fine. Okay, you should, the problem here is you should have this application opened here. Okay, so otherwise you will not be able to do, right? The background, the required application is not there. So you have to go to omaya.blogspot.com first.
So I have to close first.
Yeah, close it. Close it. Not a problem. Close it. Just browse omaya.blogspot.com. The same Chrome browser. Just browse for omaya.blogspot.com.
Omayo.
Omayo. It will come. omayo.blogspot. Yeah, blogspot.com. Yeah, that's the first one. Yes, correct.
This one?
Click on that. Just maximizing this browser. There is no problem in that. Just maximize this browser.
Maximize.
Okay, then click on the Selenium ID now. Okay, create a new project. Give some name. Any name? Anything, demo or something. Okay. Yeah. Say okay. Select any command. Select anything. Anything is fine. Just select anything. Yeah, now it got enabled. Now here you need to paste the CSS selector or XPath expression. How to find it? You need to inspect on the button, right? So just do that on the page. Yeah, better to do with the page. Go to the Omaya web, switch to this Omaya. Yeah, just go there and scroll down. You'll see the button. Scroll down. Button 2, right click, say inspect. And no, don't go there. Here you see styles are there, events. This is a main tag, right? Elements is a main tag, and under that we have styles. You can see that, right? Below styles, event listeners, DOM breakpoints, properties. Did you install CrowPath? I don't see you have installed CrowPath here. You didn't install CrowPath, right? Okay, you have to install CrowPath. So click on another tab here, new tab, not here, in the Chrome browser itself. Just click on the new tab. Just type crow path. Just type search for crow path. CHRO. ROPATH. Yeah, enter. No, don't click on that second link. Just click on the second link. That will be better, right? You have the options to choose between the browsers. So better to go this link. Even that one also works. First one also will work, but better to go here. Now click on download for Chrome. Okay, you'll be taken to the add-on page. You need to click on add to Chrome on the right side. On the right side, add to Chrome. Yeah, click on that. Add extension. So wait for a while. Yeah, now crow path has been added, right? Now restart the browser completely again. Close the Chrome browser. All tabs in the Chrome browser. Just restart. Even close the Selenium IDE also. Now open the Chrome browser. Yeah, go to that omaya.blogspot.com first. Before opening anything, you have to go to omaya.blogspot. Don't click on that. That's not required. Okay, that is not how the crow path works. Just close it. No need. Just go to this URL, omaya.blogspot.com. Omaya. Yeah, it's coming, right? So yes. Yeah, the first link. Yes. Yes. Now click on Selenium ID on the top. Selenium ID on the top icon add-on. Yeah. Now, okay. So the mistake you are doing there is like you are not opening the application. Okay. First, your test application has to be opened. In our case, it is omaya.blogspot.com. You opened it. Then you have to open the Selenium ID. Now click on the create a new project. Enter the project name. Okay. Say okay. Now you need to select a command.
Whichever.
Anything is fine. Anything, just to enable the options. That's it. Okay, you are not going to use a command. Don't click on anything. Just come to target. Click inside the target. Here we need to type the locator, right? So how to get the locator? Now do the steps like switch to Omaya and then inspect the button two. This time.
Button. Hit the button.
Yes, right click inspect. Now elements tab is selected. Under that you see crow path anywhere on the top bottom? You see under elements we have styles, event listeners, DOM breakpoints, properties on the top. Just on the top, just scroll. No, not there, the second section or below section. Yeah, you can see crow path, right? Just click on that. Now you can see some locators coming, right? For button two, you see button 2 is already highlighted state. That means these are the locators for button 2. Now take any locator, say CSS selector. Okay, click on the edit button. So that click on edit beside the, yeah, other, you can even filter also. Yeah, just click on the drop down, select CSS selector last option. Okay, now click on the edit. Pin kind of icon is there, right? Pin kind of icon beside the CSS selector. Besides the CSS selector, just down, yeah, that thing. Just click on that. Now copy this, and go to Selenium ID. Switch to Selenium ID again. No, don't open. It's already opened, right? You don't have to. Okay, that's fine. CSS is equal to paste it.
Paste
whatever you copied just now. Okay. Now click on search button. That means it's getting highlighted, right? You are seeing some highlighting, right? Again, click on the search button. You can see that, okay, in action. Not there in the Selenium ID. Switch to Selenium ID. Click on search button as you can and observe the button too. When you click on the, yeah, click on that. You see what's happening?
It's highlighting.
highlighting, right? This is how it works. You understood? Okay. Okay, you can stop sharing your screen. So guys, this is all about locators. Just practice whatever I explained today. Okay, so I explained what is the purpose of locators, why Selenium requires locators, what are the different type of locators. I prepared some HTML basics which are required for understanding the locators. Then practically demonstrated most of the locators, only except one is left in, that is class locator, which I will be covering in the Selenium WebDriver sessions anyhow. Then if multiple locators can be used for same UI element, locators priority is required. Okay, so this is the priority you have to follow. Then I explained you how to auto generate the XPath expressions and CSS selectors for locating the UI elements. Okay, so guys, this is all about locators. Any questions, guys, before we wind up today's session? Any questions? Okay.
No.
Okay, fine. Great. So but practice it, guys. But practice it after the session. Try to practice all the steps. Okay, it's better to practice. So that's it, guys. If nothing is there, we can meet tomorrow at the same time. Okay. So bye, guys. See you tomorrow. Yeah, fine. Bye bye.